H-E-A-D-N.
It's Headphones Neil! What's up, guys, and welcome back to another episode of Headphones Neil Reviews. I'm your host, as always, Headphones Neil, bringing you my hodgepodge mix of items to review. I actually got a lot of stuff for this week, as I was able to push through a lot of content. So I was able to get through Indiana Jones and the Dial of Destiny. I caught up on a lot of Stargate SG-1, and then, of course, Ahsoka and more brutal Wolfenstein 3D gameplay. So let's jump right into it and get through all of the updates that I want to give for this week. So to start it off, as I mentioned, I had a chance to watch Indiana Jones and the Dial of Destiny. I ended up starting the movie straight from the beginning and watching it all the way through without falling asleep like I did before. And overall, I want to say that it was a decent film. A lot of the visuals and themes and interactions and all of that felt very much in line with the first three films, Grail and the other two, excluding Crystal Skull. That one was okay, but I actually do want to rewatch those first four films in order just to see generally how that all fits in with stuff. I know the ending was a bit of contention. Some people didn't like Shia LaBeouf. For the most part, I thought the movie was fine, and overall it felt in line with the first three films. Just the whole thing with the aliens and the spaceship and all of that stuff just got a little bit more out there. But then in the context of things like the Holy Grail and the evil spirits and all that, it kind of also did fit a little bit. So with that being said, with Dial of Destiny, my biggest problem was that it felt like it was playing it a little bit too safe, but they were also trying to recapture the look and the feel and the feelings that you got from the first three films, which was kind of there, and it was okay. And then you also have to deal with things like Harrison Ford being older, but they played into that well, where he's a professor that, you know, hasn't gotten the fame and glory and all of that, so he's still trying to just make it by with his life. He's at that point of retirement and all of that. So all of that was fine, but just didn't feel like it had that it factor. And not to say that the acting was bad. You know, Harrison Ford was good. Phoebe Waller-Bridge was good. Mikkelsen was good as well. Hasala in there was good. Like, all of the individual pieces were good. But for some reason, it just felt like it was missing something. It was good that I did like the part where they go back in time to the Roman era to visit Archimedes. I really wasn't expecting that, so I thought that was good. And I got to thinking that I wonder if maybe spending more time in the past, like making it a Back to the Future movie, would have made the film better. Because it feels like they spent maybe a little bit too much time in the present dealing with Harrison Ford being much older now. So I don't know, for me it was decent, not great, not bad, but it didn't, and I could see what they were trying to do, but it didn't quite hold as much interest as I thought it would. So if I was to grade it, I would probably give it a grade of about a 75% to 80%, a solid C to B minus, because for the most part I enjoyed it. The visuals were nice, interactions individually were good, but it just felt like there was something over the top that was missing as far as the excitement goes, which the first three films definitely had. I mean, even the ones with the stones and in India and all of that stuff. Like, my memory of it was that the initial part didn't pick up as fast as I thought it would, but then just over the course of the film, it did build up enough to hold my, or to be an exciting, fun movie, even though it was probably the least favorite of the three for me. So maybe, I guess in retrospect, it'd probably be like Temple of Doom and probably Dial of Destiny are probably on par for quality and excitement, whereas the Holy Grail and the other one are the better of the two, and then Crystal Skull is probably still on the lower end just because it ended kind of weird. Not to say that I think it's a bad movie, it's just probably the least of my favorite. It's probably lower on the scale of good films that fit in with the themes of everything else. So, that being said, if you like Indiana Jones and want to be a completionist, definitely check it out. If you're checking it out just for completionist sake, like I said, it's not a bad movie, but not great. But definitely still watch it. It's not a bad or terrible movie. You'll make your way through it. But for me, it was really, really slow and a drag to get through. So just know that, I guess, going into it, that it's not going to be quite on par as the first three films. But they're trying, and it kind of falls apart beyond that. But that's about the level you're going to get from it. So, like, think of the first three films, but dial it back about 10%, and you'll get about that level quality of film. So with that being said, I also had a chance to catch up on Ahsoka, so season 1, episode 4, Fallen Jedi, and the problems that I had with the last episode are kind of made up for in this episode, to the point where it feels like episode 3 should have been mixed in with the first two episodes, adjust the time frame a little bit, and episode 4 should have been episode 3. So we have, you know, lightsaber battles, the star map, Hera forming up a squadron of X-Wings. And so, overall, in general, the episode was good just because we have, you know, Sabine with a lightsaber. So think of that scene with Finn from The Force Awakens, but in the form of Sabine fighting the Sith or Dark Jedi apprentice or whatever. And then, of course, the ending of the episode where we have Ahsoka going back to the Worlds Beyond Worlds, and the revelation that Anakin is there and talking to her. So he wasn't expecting her to show up so soon or come back so soon as the cliffhanger to the episode. So I'm really curious to see what they're going to do for the next episode, how they're going to potentially tie in Anakin with Thrawn, which makes me wonder if they're going to bring in that story of how Thrawn and Anakin met up. Maybe Anakin knows where Thrawn is now because he put him there to keep him out of the way from returning. So overall, it was a good build up to that. So we'll see. Hopefully, we also get to see why Sabine decided to, what looks to me like she's pretending to go with the Night Sister and the Dark Jedi guy just to maybe get to Ezra to bring him back. That bringing him back is important. So all in all, a good episode, very suspenseful. I like the lightsaber fights, they were all good. I wasn't expecting an episode with battle bots, but that was a particularly good part of the episode. And then also we got to see the X-Wings back with Hera, back to seeing Home One. Also, it's one of those things where I like that they have that connection with the Mr. Kim from Kim's Convenience. I always forget the guy's name, but we got to see him. So all in all, for me, a good episode. So I can't wait to see what next week's episode brings us as far as Sabine going down the hyperspace lane, and then what happens between Ahsoka and Anakin. Otherwise, I've also been catching up on or continuing my rewatch of Stargate SG-1, so I've gotten through seasons 5 and 6. Nothing special here to talk about. We have a little bit more universe building, so we have the team going out, interacting with other cultures a little bit more. We have the introduction of the X-302 fighter, or the first interstellar spacecraft, and then we have the X-303, which is basically the first battle cruiser, the Prometheus. So I thought that's always a fun conversation when Colonel O'Neill tells Major Carter that they rejected his idea of calling it the Enterprise, and then their conversation that the X-302 doesn't have phasers, and then Carter makes a joke about activating the ejection system. So things like that. So we're basically now into more world building as far as humans going out meeting and creating ties with other cultures and peoples on other planets. Still dealing with the replicators a little bit. So we have, you know, the time dilation machine that they help the Asgard turn back on. And then their double cross of the one replicator guy that's going to come back to bite them. And I forget if it was season 7 or 8, definitely not in season 6. So but whenever that happens, we're going to have that stuff happening. So all in all, good stuff. As far as my favorite episode, I want to say it's Abyss. And that's the episode where Colonel O'Neill is captured by Ball. He was with the Tok'ra for having the symbiote implanted in him. So I thought that was a particularly good episode as far as showing the pain that he's in, dealing with his human side, wanting to go back for for Ball's slave that helped him escape to begin with, that the Tok'ra was in love with. Ball was good. This was before he got to be more of his over-the-top self, I guess. So this was probably his best episode, aside from that one a couple seasons ago during the Gould summit, where they all are trying to decide what to do with Anubis, and they bring him back into the Gould system wars. So he was fine in that one, but I liked him better here, just with his methodical way of torturing Colonel O'Neill and all of that for the episode. And then of course the surprise cameo that was in here was, I didn't realize that Grace Park was in an episode of Stargate SG-1. So when I was watching that episode where they're doing the foothold situation, I kept thinking, like, this looks a lot like a young Grace Park. I couldn't quite place her, so I finally looked at the information in the Amazon Prime app, and turns out that was her. So I thought that was a nice cameo. And then a few episodes later, I didn't make note of the episode name, but there was a retrospective episode where when General Hammond decides to tell the other major superpowers of the Stargate program, and then we have the back and forth with him and Senator Kinsey, as far as Kinsey still, he's trying to take over the NID to take over the Stargate program and all of that. It looks like he's winning. And General Hammond pulls the ace in his sleeve, which he calls Thor to tell the other world leaders that while their conversations and friendship with Earth does not depend on the current administration of the Stargate program, they would actually prefer it because they've had that interaction. They're the ambassadors across the galaxy. They're doing a good job. And changing that now would cause more harm than good, basically. But between that and General Hammond telling the other world leaders that they have to be ambassadors to the world, to the universe, not just each other, and put their own petty squabbles ahead, like out there between each other, and cause more problems in the universe. It was good to have that twofold with Hammond and Thor to counter what Kinsey was saying in Kinsey's quest for power and all that. So it's kind of putting your best foot forward, and that it's not just about them, it's about other cultures and respecting their identity and beliefs and all of that stuff. So definitely a good episode there as well. So with that being said, I'm now starting my way into season 7. So basically that's kind of where I'm at for that. As far as the update for Brutal Wolfenstein 3D and my gameplay of that, I did have a chance to get through episode 2, Operation Eisenfaust, and I'm probably saying that wrong, but essentially we have a doctor creating a mutant army to try and take over the world that way. So you have to go through all these levels and into his laboratory to ultimately defeat him and take down that project. So overall, I actually liked this episode more than the last episode 1 with the escape, just because this one, while it did feel like you were going through his laboratory and a lot of the levels might have been repeats, there was enough uniqueness in the Brutal Wolfenstein recreation of it where it did feel like it was a little bit more speedier and a little bit more fun to go through, even though there were some levels that were very complex with different mazes and it was easy for me to get lost and stuff. But it was still a very interesting and intriguing episode, whereas the last one was just, it was generally repetitive until the very, very end. So I liked episode 2 quite a bit. It did seem to move a lot smoother. So, you know, going through the levels, not to say they were easier, but the mix between the mutant zombies, the Nazi officers, and then that speedier white coat one, and then you have a different bunch of scientists in there. So all in all, it was a very good episode. It made me enjoy it quite a bit. So I actually can't wait to go into the third episode and see how that goes, and ultimately having to deal with Hitler and his four chain gun arms or whatever, so we'll see how that goes. But that's where I'm at right now. Overall, a good episode, good level designs, except for that one, I think level 7 or I think it was level 6 or 7 with all the fog with the maze I got stuck in, so I had to mess with the color a little bit. But overall, a good presentation there, so I'll say that I did have fun in that episode. It was a good variety, so I can't wait to see what the third episode brings, if they're still going to have the mutants or if they're going to introduce another different kind of enemy to take over from the mutants or things like that. So that's all there is for this particular episode. So like I said, I'll be continuing with the brutal Wolfenstein gameplay, Stargate SG-1, and Ahsoka. I don't know if I'll be watching any other movies this particular week. I think there was one or two that showed up on my radar that I do potentially want to watch, but I have a note somewhere to take a look at the rental or see where it's streaming. So if there's time, I'll probably watch something else like that and take a look, and then just take it from there and review it when I have something else watched. But at least those first three items I mentioned will be on the dock for next week with updates for where I'm at with that. So that is all for this particular episode. If you have any questions, comments, feedback, or anything like that, want to help support the show, subscribe and all of that, you can visit the website at HeadphonesNeil.reviews. All the gameplay videos are posted up on the YouTube channel at youtube.com/patelN01. And of course, you can get early access to the podcast as well as an ad-free version of the episodes at patreon.com/patelN01. But that is all for this particular episode. Thanks for tuning in, and until next time.